For a second, it sounded like I was mic'd every time.
It's 4 o'clock, so I'll go ahead and call the meeting, the August 11th, 2008 meeting of the Salina City Commission to order. Would the clerk please call the roll?
Mayor Vanir.
Here.
Commissioner Jelka.
Here.
Commissioner Larson.
Here.
Commissioner Peck.
Here.
Commissioner Perney.
Here.
I would invite everyone to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance and a moment of silence.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Now have the citizens forum, a time for citizens to come before the commission to speak on anything that's not on the official agenda. Is there anyone from the public here today? Not Mr. Frazier, you have an introduction?
Yes, we would like to introduce the new city engineer for the city of Salina, Dan Stack. Dan is with us here today, and we're very happy to have him on board.
Welcome aboard, Dan. Awards and proclamations.
Item 4.1, the day of August 21st, 2008, as Live United Day in the City of Salina. Andy Martin, United Way Director, John Quinley, 2008 United Way Campaign Chair, and Larry Fife, President of the Salina Area United Way Board, are present to read the proclamation.
Whereas the mission of the Salina Area United Way is to improve lives and strengthen the community through leadership, partnership, and investment. And whereas the Salina Area United Way's goal is to build a stronger, healthier, more caring community by building self-reliance, preparing for life, providing basic needs, and rebuilding lives.
And whereas the Salina Area United Way is a recognized community-wide convener of businesses, service organizations, and individual leaders for prioritizing and addressing important issues facing the Salina area.
And whereas the United Way has the unique distinction of leading and coordinating Salina's only annual community-wide workplace and individual giving fundraising campaign, whereas as that 2008 United Way campaign offers the citizens of Salina the opportunity to invest in our community by giving, to champion the cause of by advocating, and to give their time by volunteering. Now, therefore, I, John Vanir, I'm not John Vanir, but I'm Andy Martin, but reading for John Vanir, Mayor of the City of Salina, do hereby proclaim August 21st, 2008 as Live United Day, and that on the first day of every month for the rest of 2008 and 2009, we will celebrate Living United as One. Get it? Like on the first, we're all one. Anyway, okay. So now I'm reading for all of us, okay, one voice. We encourage all citizens of Salina to join in us by giving, advocating, and volunteering in the 2009-2008 Live United campaign. Thank you very much.
Do you have any particular events planned for the 21st? Or?
We do. August 21st is a campaign kickoff. We'll be at the Dickinson Theaters in the Central Mall, a little bit different venue for us this year. And we'll have two different groups coming through, one at 11:30, one at 12:30. And we encourage all of you to be there.
Great. Thank you. I have a copy, signed copy of your proclamation. Okay, public hearings and items scheduled for a certain time.
5.1, the 2009 budget. 5.1A, public hearing on the 2009 budget. 5.1B, second reading ordinance number 08-10457, attesting the possible increase in taxes for the budget year 2009. Item 5.1C, first reading ordinance number 08-10461, adopting the 2009 budget. Items 5.1D, resolution number 08-6545, providing for the appropriation by fund of the budget year for the year beginning January 1st, 2009. Item 5.1E, resolution number 08-6544, establishing various fees for services and adopting the City of Salina comprehensive fee schedule. Item 5.1F, consider and adopt the amended 2008 through 2012 capital improvement program.
Mr. Franz.
Mayor and Commissioners, thank you. The action today is the culmination of the 2009 budget process, almost in time to start the 2010 budget process. No. I'm sorry. According to state statute, we're required to hold a public hearing on the proposed budget on or before August 15th. And of course, the notice of hearing was published on July 30th, which provided the required 10 days notice. We did include a copy of the notice with your packet. Once again this year, we did publish an early bird notice in April, as well as some additional notification within the last couple of weeks. To invite people to participate in the meetings. No general public comments were received as a result of that. Final proposed budget includes total expenditures, excluding interfund transfers and reserves, of $69,429,380. This is approximately, after we adjust for some changes in reporting, is about $1,100,000 more than it was last year, or about 1.6%. We've faced some unusual budget challenges this year, slow growing revenues, some more rapidly growing costs, salaries, health plan, loss of personal property value due to the state exemption of business personal property, and so on. Developed a number of strategies to deal with that. That includes went through several times did trim budget line item requests. We've deferred have recommended no cost of living increase with regard to the salary plan. We are proposing a reduction in authorized staffing by up to 15 positions through attrition over the next 18-month period. We're going through an increasing in a comprehensive fashion fees and charges for city services, and are proposing a increase in the property tax levy rate, or the estimated property tax levy rate, from 23.959 mils to 26 mils. Today, City Commission should open the public hearing to take comments regarding the proposed 2009 budget. This is the time that we have set aside formally for citizens to make known their opinions and suggestions. As I said, the budget as published contemplates a total city mill levy of 26 mills compared to a current levy of 23.959 mills. Total taxes levied will change from $9,409,338 to $10,384,833. As is shown on the table on your information sheets, that works out to about a $23.50 change on a $100,000 home. Modest rate increases have been proposed for city user fees, emergency medical services 5%, sewer rates 5%, sanitation fees 5%, solid waste fees will increase by $1 per ton, or about 3.5%. Golf course fees will be considered later in the year, but are also likely due to be considered for some modest increases. After closing the public hearing, the City Commission should consider the actions necessary to implement the 2009 budget. These include the following, or the following actions are necessary: convene the public hearing, and then close it after comments are heard. Consider the second reading of the ordinance number 08-10457, which attests to the possible increase in taxes. This ordinance was considered first reading on August 4th. No comments have been received. Consider the first reading of ordinance number 08-10461, adopting the 2009 budget. That essentially authorizes implementation of the full budget and authorizes and directs the city manager to implement and administer the 2009 budget. Consider resolution number 086545, which appropriates by fund the budget for the year beginning January 1st, 2009. Consider resolution 086544, which establishes the fees and charges. And then finally, consider and approve the 2008 to 2012 CIP, which is an action by motion. There will be one remaining action relating to the budget process, and that is the consent to the Airport Authority mill levy, which we do on an annual basis. That action is scheduled for consideration at the August 25th City Commission meeting. I would entertain any questions you might have at this point.
Are there any questions of staff? If not, I'll open the public hearing and invite the public to come forward and comment on the 2009 budget.
Gary Schwarzenegger, 528 South College. Is this the appropriate time to say I would like to be among the first on record advocating you vote yes on the 2.04 mill levy? Yeah, I happen to be chatting. Anyway, I want to do that. I want to be the first. I'm sure I'm one among many citizens today that are going to say you've done a terrific job with the budget, and that we are all here and going to advocate for voting for the 2.04 mill levy increase, which, in my simple, humble mind, I also thought maybe I heard you say that's about $23 on a $100,000 piece of property. I had thought it would be about 29. I think I got that from the Salina Journal. But anyway, so that's sort of less than that'd be about $2.20 fancy cup of coffee or a bag of potato chips. And I think it's worth that to all of us. And I thank you, Mayor, for your leadership on having us consider a mill levy increase first time in 30 years.
Thank you. Any other comment?
Were you just joking, Gary?
Yeah.
What's that? No, I'm dead serious. Now, that's a challenge to, I realize not everybody in the room is going to address that issue, but I wish they would.
Any other public comment on the 2009 budget? I will close the public hearing at this time and bring it back to the commission to start down the list of action items.
Mayor, I move that we approve on second reading ordinance 08-10457, attesting to the possible increase in taxes levied for budget year 2009.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded on second reading to approve ordinance 08-10457. This was passed on first reading August 4th. There have been no comments received. Would the clerk please call the roll?
Commissioner Jelka?
Aye.
Commissioner Larson?
Aye.
Commissioner Peck?
Aye.
Commissioner Perney?
Aye.
Mayor Vanier?
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. 5.1C.
Mayor, I move that we adopt ordinance number 08-10461, adopting the 2009 budget on first reading.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt ordinance 08-10461 on first reading. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. 5.1D.
Mayor, I'd move that resolution number 086545, providing for the appropriation by fund of the budget for the year beginning January 1, 2009, be approved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve resolution number 086545. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. 5.1E.
Mayor, I'd move we adopt resolution number 08-6544, establishing fees for services.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt resolution 086544. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. 5.1F.
Mayor, I move that we approve the 2008 through 2012 capital improvement plan.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt the amended 2008 through 2012 capital improvement program. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. Consent agenda.
Item 6.1, approve the minutes of August 4th, 2008. Item 6.2, authorize the purchase of traffic signal battery backup system, project number 082722, from Gady Sales Company Incorporated in the amount of $31,500. Item 6.3, award a bid for LED traffic signal lights, project number 082722, to Traffic Signal Controls Incorporated in the amount of $19,442.
Is there any item that a commissioner would like pulled from the consent agenda? If not, I would entertain some action.
Mayor, I'd move we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. To development business.
Item 7.1, resolution number 086543, authorizing a license agreement with GLP Real Estate LLC to authorize the installation of a storm sewer discharge line across and within the public right-of-way of Marketplace and South 9th Street.
Mr. Andrew.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor and Commissioners, this is a request that came to us from the engineer for GLP Real Estate. They are the owners of property on Marketplace, directly south of Hong Kong Buffet, to the north of that, and not to be confused with is the Blind Pig. This is a plan for construction of a barbecue restaurant, and a building permit has been applied for and plans are under review. This area of South 9th Street has been designated as a critical drainage area, so some form of on-site stormwater detention will be required, and that is under review. But the request here is not to approve their particular detention plan, but for them to know that they have your authorization to construct a pipeline that would cross Marketplace and tie into the storm sewer system in 9th Street. It would be similar to what was approved just to the north with Hong Kong Buffet, where they had a pipeline that also discharges into 9th Street. So their request is for you to approve the attached license agreement and authorize them to construct a pipeline that would be private in nature across that right-of-way. That way they would have assurances of where their on-site discharge would go. So that is the request so that they can move forward with their plans for how they'll discharge stormwater from the site. I'd be happy to address any questions about the location or the plan.
Questions of staff?
But currently there's no word on the detention pond or if they're going to ponds or they'll have to do any other kind of.
They've got several options. What Hong Kong Buffet did was they put underground storage tanks in. They have the option if they don't, presently they're not indicating giving up any land for a pond, so they're indicating storage underneath the parking lot in some sort of pipelines or tubes, but that will all be worked out between their engineer and our engineering staff is the ultimate amount of storage capacity they need to have. But one thing they do know is they're going to get it off site, they're going to have to discharge it to Ninth Street.
And they're aware of that?
Yes.
Correct. Okay.
In the spring that we had this year, the Hong Kong Buffet had no problems with their underground storage or discharge with that method?
Not that I'm aware of, unless some other department is aware of it, but we've not heard of backups or that system is being overwhelmed. But the idea is that to temporarily detain or store the water and then release it after the volumes in the storm sewer system have gone down, so they don't overload it all at once. And as we could tell, there were not backups in the parking lot or any public inconvenience that we heard about.
That was my concern. I want to make sure that they're aware that if the detention ponds on the outside is not going to be sufficient, they are aware that they may have to put in some kind of drainage underneath.
They are. Or the engineer is attempting to do those calculations so that they will be able to have sufficient storage volume. But their plan is to do it underground and not with a surface pond.
Okay.
Any other questions of staff? Any public comment? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I move we approve resolution number 08-6543, authorizing the mayor to execute a license agreement with GLP Real Estate LLC to allow the installation of a private storm sewer line across and within the marketplace right away east of South 9th Street.
Second. It's been moved and seconded to approve resolution 086543. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. Administration.
Item 8.1, first reading ordinance number 08-10458, levying special assessments against certain lots and pieces of property to pay the cost of abatement of nuisances.
Mr. France.
Mayor, Commissioner, thank you. Each year the city sends out nuisance abatement notices to property owners notifying them that they must abate a nuisance. Might be mowing, cleaning, might be demolition on their property within a specified amount of time, or the city will do the work for them and bill them for the cost. In those cases where the property owner does not choose to abate the nuisance, the city typically contracts to do so, sends a bill to the property owner. Property owners are informed that if they do not pay the amounts due, it will be added to their taxes as a special assessment. Ordinance number 08-10458 details the amounts remaining due by tract and levies an assessment against their property. Attached to the sheet is a report showing all the amounts billed, paid, and remaining due. The total amount billed was $19,159.73. Of that amount, $4,755.72 was paid. The remaining amount to be assessed is $14,404.01. Staff recommendation is to approve the ordinance on first reading.
Questions to staff?
Well, I just have a question. What does it mean? Gosh, I thought I had it in my mind. Secure a house and garage? What do you mean by secure a house?
Generally, that would mean that we would secure the windows and doors to make sure that entry is not easily obtained. Maybe board them up or lock them so that
because it's vacant.
So that you wouldn't have kids or whomever, you know, in the house doing things that perhaps they would be better off not doing there.
Thank you.
Other questions to staff?
Thank you.
Public comment? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor Vanier, I move to approve ordinance 08-10458 on first reading, levying special assessments against certain lots and pieces of property to pay the cost of abatement of nuisances.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve ordinance 08-10458 on first reading. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Against, same sign. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 8.2, special sales tax, sub-item 8.2A, first reading charter ordinance number 34, allowing the city to issue up to $12,500,000 in bonds for construction of a family aquatic park. Item 8.2B, first reading ordinance number 08-10460, submitting to voters on the November 4th, 2008 general election the question of a 0.40% or 0.35% sales retailer sales tax commencing April 9, 2009 and ending April 8, 2019.
Mr. Gage.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. As the city clerk said, we have two action items in front of you. First, I'd like to say the city's current quarter-cent special sales tax will expire on June 30th of 2010. So in anticipation of that, that's why you have items in front of you related to that tax. That tax was approved by the voters on March 16th of 2004, so it was a six-year sales tax. With that, the voters also approved the following specified purposes. They approved it for use for general capital improvements, for major equipment, for parks and recreation capital improvement projects, debt service, human services grants, and economic development purposes. In addition to renewing the current sales tax, the quarter cent, it is the City Commission's direction to ask the electorate to vote on the funding for a family aquatic park. As a result, it was a commissioner's direction at a recent study session to try to put some parameters around this, and those include including the use of the tax to fund the same purposes as those in the current 1/4 cent special sales tax. Well, there was some discussion on human services, and that may be an item you want to discuss again this afternoon. You wanted to add the family aquatic park to that. A direction was provided to limit the total cost of a family aquatic park to $12,500,000. To submit for consideration a 3/8 cent special sales tax, and I'll talk about that increment here in just a second, and to establish a 10-year sunset on a special sales tax. It's pretty important to the public, particularly if there's a big project related to it. Again, the modification on that increment, we were looking at a 1/4 cent needing an 1/8. When we looked at the increments that are provided for by statute, we learned that it had to be 0.05, so it gives you a choice of 0.4 or 0.35. We kind of attached a cash flow projection based on those two scenarios, and basically what we found is, and a lot of it is the assumption you have going in, if your assumption is on a, say, a $12.5 million family aquatic park, that after you make debt service payments on that, on the assumption that that would get approved, you're looking at what would the remaining amount of sales tax dollars annually be that would be available for general capital improvements. And what we've done is tried to compare that to what you would have in 2010 with the current 1/4 cent sales tax. If the voters approved a 0.4% sales tax, it would be pretty close. You'd have a plus about $3,000 a year. It's an estimate, and there are a lot of factors in there. If you went with a 0.35% sales tax, be negative roughly about $500,000 a year. So it's a pretty big difference in there. We wanted to make sure and just lay these out in front of you so you understood that. What that's based on, it's about $2.77 million a year, which is what, if we just had the current 1/4 cent all the way through and it never quit, that's about what we'd project it to provide for general capital improvements in 2010. So we wanted to put that in front of you, and then also we have a home rule charter ordinance. Basically, the charter ordinance provides provides a means for cities in Kansas to use their home rule authority to exempt themselves from statutory requirements that are not applied uniformly to all cities in Kansas by the legislature. In this instance, charter ordinance number 34 would allow the commission to authorize and issue bonds up to $12,500,000 as written for the family aquatic park. So it's specific to the family aquatic park. Use of this certainly assumes the passage by the electorate of the proposed sales tax. Obviously, you wouldn't do this if you didn't have a funding mechanism to do that. There's another change in there I wanted to make sure and highlight. We looked at the other values, and you had a currently $250,000 as a maximum for streets, bridges, and viaducts that are not on main traffic ways. Got a typo here. Public parks, public buildings, and stormwater drainage systems. We felt that $1 million is probably more realistic for that. So it's more of a housekeeping item with regards to that. We looked at these, and we obviously looked at the strategic plan, and we feel there are a couple goals in your strategic plan that probably relate. One is to create a uniformly managed and master planned Kenwood Park, Kenwood and Oakdale Park destination area featuring recreation, tourism, entertainment, hotel lodging, surrounding mixed-use development, green space, and direct linkage to downtown. And obviously, this family aquatic park is a big part of that. Goal three is to provide the highest quality of services consistent with governing body direction, available resources, and staff commitment to quality. And to be quite honestly, the current pool that we have doesn't provide the service that, we believe has been expressed at the level that has been expressed as a need by the folks in Salina. Certainly, we think the proposal would more than do that. I do want to talk about a couple things. You have, I'll go ahead and say you have a couple options related to each of these items. Agenda item 8.2A is the charter ordinance, and the options are approved charter ordinance is submitted on first reading or with the desired amendments, or don't approve it at all. The second item relates to approving the ordinance that submits the sales tax to the voters. One thing that you'll need to do is fill in the blank on the 0.4% or 0.35%, and then you may possibly have some questions as it relates to the language of that as well. Let me get to a question I think is a big question. First, I want to emphasize, I can't overemphasize that the tax is a capital improvement sales tax. It's not a swimming pool tax. That's one major project, but it's not even, it doesn't even use a majority of what this tax would fund. So we got to keep in mind the streets, the equipment replacement, economic development, possibility of continuing human service grants, and all the other capital improvement uses that our current capital improvement tax provides. Those are really, in my opinion, the biggest emphasis here, because we need those resources to continue. Certainly the water park or aquatic park has been something that's been discussed for a long time, and there seems to be a lot of desire to take another look at that, and that's why that's here. One question you might have is, and I think you're going to be asked some questions, is, Jason, we have a 25-yard lap swimming area that we talked about before that's conceptually in this design. And the design isn't finished. We're still working on that. And certainly once action's taken here, then that will speed up quite a lot. And we'll finish scoping and bring that to you. You'll have, who knows, study session or two or three, whatever it takes for you to be comfortable and stay within the time frame you need to finally scope what you really want to do there. But you're going to get the question over and over, and it does affect the amount of your, particularly this home rule action that you have in front of you for $12.5 million. And the question is if we wanted to do a 50-meter or Olympic size, which will affect the width a little bit, pool rather than a 25-yard, do we have the ability to do it within this? That's an important question. The answer is if you went with the 0.4%, it would be a lot easier to do this because right now, if you didn't do that, you'd have about the same amount of money left over for general capital improvements. We estimate, based on a really rough conceptual number, of about $1.5 to $1.7 million more for the 50-meter. And that more means that you're keeping it separate body of water, so that all the really shallow recreational activity is still separated, and you have that separate 50-meter area, which is consistent with the 25-yard concept that was discussed. That would be about $1.5 to $1.7 million. We believe that would cost, on average annually, somewhere between $150,000 and $200,000 more a year for debt service. So with that in mind, you could equate that to say, if we did that, we would have roughly about $150,000 to $200,000 left for general capital improvements than we have, than you're used to today, relatively speaking, when you compare. So it's not a tremendous issue from the ability to finance that with the sales tax if you wanted to do that. Now, the bigger question probably is if you really want to do that. If you do want to do that, then what you'll need to do is you'll probably need to amend the maximum number on the – you got a few options, actually. You would amend the maximum number on that home rule charter to – it could be $14 million, $14.1, $14.2, somewhere in there. It's a pretty big number. Another option is you could say, we don't want to do that. We're pretty comfortable with utilization. When we look at utilization, we're pretty comfortable with at least the concept of a 25-yard lap swim, recreational use, semi-competitive type use, certainly not meeting the standards of a full competitive swimming competition. And another option would be, yeah, you'd be happy to do it if someone's willing to donate to the project, cash infusion of, you know, about $1.5 to $1.7 million. it's a pretty quick time frame for that kind of fundraising is the only thing, and you really need to know, because once you take the actions today, while you may have a funding mechanism in place, we still have the bond ordinance or the charter ordinance. It's not to say you couldn't change that, but again, the scoping of the project's going to happen pretty quickly in just a few weeks after this, so you really kind of know where you want to be on that issue. So I don't want to cloud the issue, but I do know you'll have questions, because there's a lot of interest in that, and I think what I'm trying to address is at this today is not necessarily whether you should or shouldn't, but it's simply if that's something that you feel you want to do, I want to be able to answer the financial questions related to it and the timing questions. With that, also have our Finance Director Rod Franz, who can help with some financial questions. Jared Johnson is here and has done a lot of the legal work for us on the ballot language and so forth. So I'd be happy to take any questions that you might have.
Questions to staff.
Something's kind of new, the date matter. I always assumed that we would do this so that it kicked in when the current one expires. Where did the April 1st date pop up all of a sudden?
Commissioner, I'll have Jared go ahead and address that question for you.
Mayor, Commissioners, I assume you're referring to the April 1st, 2009 start date that's in the ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
There is clearly a decision between whether to start the sales tax in 2010 when the current quarter cent expires or the three-quarter cent, or excuse me, the proposed 3/8, which is actually 0.35 or 0.4. That is simply a choice of preference and financing. The only concern from a legal standpoint, because this is a special use or special purpose sales tax, is that the city does not exceed a 1% cap. From a legal perspective, that would be my only concern as far as when to start it. The natural start point for a tax after election is 90 days after some information has been provided after the election to Kansas Department of Revenue, and then at the beginning of that next quarter after the 90 days. That's a long formula. Basically, that means the earliest start point for this tax could be April 1st, 2009, for my calculations.
I've always assumed, and tell me if I'm assuming correct, but if this were to pass and the facility was constructed in 2009, financed by temporary notes, opened in 2010, this, if it were renewed, would kick in about the time the payments started.
Mr. Rod, to address, I think that's probably true on the assumption that we would apply temporary notes, and we typically wouldn't.
Yeah, if you follow that kind of normal process, it's true that the first bond payments would come through in 2010. The issue is the tax at, if we wait for the currently authorized tax to expire, that expires in mid-2010. The new tax, or the enhanced tax, would take effect July 1st of 2010, so we would be attempting to pay a first full year's worth of bond payments with perhaps 3 full months of tax revenue. So there's going to be a little, we would have to, and we could do that, we could schedule a payment so that it would fit that kind of cash flow, but it's going to be a little bit unusual that first year, and then of course we'd have to have higher payments in following years. So we could make it work either way. There's always the possibility of bonding this kind of project without going through a temporary note process, which would save us a year's worth of interest costs.
A couple other things. One, I want to say, I was hoping, and I still am, for a much shorter ballot question, just a few comments I'll make right at the moment before I go to my next question. I think it would read a lot better if we just said 10 years after its commencement, the proceeds of which shall be used only to pay the cost of capital improvement projects. I don't see why we need to. I'd take the word general out and parks and recreation capital improvement projects also. Seem to be unnecessary verbiage. I also, property tax stabilization is kind of implied in this whole thing. We're deciding we want to pay this with sales tax or with property tax. I noticed that on the blue front blue sheet, you left that out when you did your list. I think we ought to leave it out the ballot question just because it's implied. The next to last line, you have the establishment of the Economic Development Fund. I think we ought to put continuation up because we already have that. That's in place right now. And I've said a number of times I'm going to oppose the human service grant phrase and would vote against the whole thing if that was included in there. I should ask this when we were voting on the capital improvement plan, but before this special sales tax went into effect, we were spending about $1.4 million a year on street maintenance, coming from the gas tax. And when this came in, we kind of split it up to where we're doing $1 million from the gas tax and $1 million from the special sales tax.
If you look in your historical budget, you'll find somewhere around that $1.4 million divided by streets and sidewalks and ramps. The change this year is a presumption that the gas prices are going to cause people to drive less or drive different types of vehicles to use less fuel. Therefore, you'll have less fuel tax. What that means is it's a pretty conservative estimate. But if the revenues keep coming in, all we need to do is amend the budget, and you still have those available for whatever qualifying expenditures you want to use. So, let's say halfway through the year, we find we're actually ahead of where we think we'll be with the budget. You can amend, and we can bring some, because you'll have a list of projects where we won't be able to afford to do them all. We can certainly bring some forward then as well. So you'll still have the flexibility in the end to spend up to 1.4 if we collect that much.
Because it seems to me, and I brought this up before, that in the last 3 years since it went into effect, it's almost like we're talking about two separate programs, but we're not.
The gas tax revenue source, the $1.4 million, is used for a couple of things. It's used both for actual capital improvements, for example, it could be some street replacements, but also a lot for maintenance. It provides a lot of materials and resources for just pure maintenance, slab removals, curb and gutter, crack sealing, those types of things. You're right in the sense with the sales tax in the last 2 years and then proposed for the third year, the $1 million from the sales tax that goes in can allow us to do, for the most part, most all of those things, enhance crack sealing, micro-surfacing to keep the rain out, curb and gutter, concrete streets, asphalt streets, sidewalks. So most all of that does cross over. Probably the difference is we haven't used the special sales tax for just, for example, buying rock for just general maintenance type activities. That's pretty well come from the gas tax. But by and large, they both have been used for primarily the same thing.
Now, in the capital improvement plan we just passed, you includes a budget of about $1 million for street repair from the gas tax. So you're saying that you're expecting a big drop in the amount?
We think so, and it's a lot of it's speculation. You read a lot about SUV sales down, other car sales down. There's a presumption that there'll be fewer miles driven or at least fewer gallons purchased. It's a flat tax, so if there are fewer gallons purchased, it means there will be less gas tax in there. The numbers so far to date haven't really just shown that yet. And we don't know what kind of delay we're going to have, but we really just wanted to be on the conservative side rather than possibly over budget. But like I said, if we come through, whether it's the sixth month of the year or the third month of the year, and we find that we're just not seeing that, at any time we can amend the budget and we can allocate up to whatever we think we'll get at year end for those projects. So it really doesn't hamstring you. You have the ability to come back and add to that if you ever want to do it.
What I'm getting at, and my initial inclination is to prefer the 0.35%. I say inclination because I'm not set in stone on that, but your numbers say, well, we're going backwards about a, we'd be about a half million years short, but to me that would make up for a lot of that. I'm not sure how that got to be rolled back, or have we not been using about $1 million a year from the gas tax in the last several years?
We've used, again,
We've actually been around 2.5 million.
Yeah, somewhere between probably 2.3, 2.5 on every, just about every year in total.
I'm suggesting maybe that number isn't going to be near as big.
Yeah, I wish I could agree with that. Even with that, we're finding that we haven't been able to catch up. And as you know, we had some discussion with some of the quality of the work in the last year, and that's something that's being addressed separately. But there's a lot of street work. And one of the things that I think is probably the biggest challenges in our community is we have a lot of peripheral roads that are rural design roads that at times, over time, will come into the city. And when those come in, it's just like a South 9th or a South Ohio project. South Ohio is probably the best example of a project we are doing right now, where that was a rural road with ditches and so forth. And when that comes in, if we do bring it up to an urban standard, it's very, very expensive because those are long stretches. And those are probably as big a challenge that we have. We're still not, even with the 2.3 to 2.5 million, we're still not able to keep up with all the crack sealing and the microsurfacing we really, really should do just to help preserve the existing streets. We could do more, quite a bit more of that.
Mm-hmm. Just a couple of quick comments before I let somebody else question. I think we need to make it clear that at least a quarter cent of this is an extension. I think the Journal kind of had a misleading headline a couple weeks ago, City Commission favors 3/8 of a cent sales tax. Well, we're extending the quarter cent that's going to expire, and then we're adding a little bit on for the pool, and I think we need to make that clear.
Yeah, that's a very, very good point.
And then I didn't make this point when I was talking about human services a minute ago. I was one of the swing voters that went along with that 4 years ago, and in my estimation, that was a mistake, and that's why I'm trying to take the lead in correcting that this go around.
Other questions of staff? Just a couple comments. I'm in favor of the, when we get to it, going to the 0.4% special retailers tax, only because of the fact I've advocated for 4 years. We are so far behind in proper maintenance and with any ideas of getting ahead in the future. We really can't be short-sighted on this. As far as the human service grants, I could be convinced either way. I think it's something that needs to happen for Salina. As much comment as we've received concerning the pool, if that in fact is the choice of the voters in November, then I think it's a great deal. And I think this puts us well on the way to meet those goals. Are there any other questions or comments for staff?
I might ask a question of you, Mary. If I went along with that 0.4%, would you agree with my verbiage changes that I listed?
I guess we'll see when we vote, won't we? Is there public comment?
Schartz, and this is my daughter, Martina Schartz.
Could you give us your address, please?
Huh?
Could you give us your address,
3645
please?
South Ohio, thank Salina, you. Kansas. And as you comment, too, about Salina Journal's comments, I have a few articles, too, that I thought were important to our cause. I like Mr. Gage's comments about the options he's given the commissioners to look at, the 25-meter to the 50-meter pool and stuff. And then the meeting that Mr. Schneider held a couple weeks ago, we were able to attend, barely, because unfortunately I've spent the week in the hospital with my son. And then the last week we were in Indiana because she had qualified for her swimming to swim at a zone meet in Indiana. So we just came back from that last night. So we wanted to come to this meeting to speak our opinion about what uses Salina could get out of a 50-meter pool compared to 25-meter pool. And I see the future of the maintenance. It's a lot to look at and stuff, too. But I think the benefit that bring the community would be beneficial also. There are a lot of things. I mean, like the soccer club is able to raise money for their fields and stuff. The soccer club is a little bit larger group than ours maybe and stuff, too. But they're the only ones using it. Our 50-meter pool would be used by the whole city of Salina, and anybody can come into it. And kind of like Mr. Vidrickson's comment when he wrote in about where we are located, it's very central located and everything, and so it's easy access to all of Kansas. And him and his comment, too, was that, and where you chose to put it, too, was a very central location. But that Mr. Gage was talking about the future maintenance of it is a high priority. We all have to look at that and stuff, too. But I think Harry Kaziski had put comments on our website stuff about different uses of the pool, everything from water safety to swim lessons for all ages, kayaking, boating lessons and stuff, scuba diving. The 50-meter pool is not just for competitive swimming. It's for competitive, yes, of all ages, for all people and stuff. And how Mr. Schneider had listed at the first meeting about six different pools in the area that had been added to the different cities stuff. Four of those also are 50-meter pools. Salina is the only one that's not even considering it. That's why we're confused at what the difference is. Kind of like Salina is really big about getting their football, baseball, soccer, all, and tennis, all anything they can help with the students or with the children to keep them active, keep them doing something they want to do. You know, I have a 4.0 straight average students too, who loves to swim, qualifies for competitions all over the United States. But swimming doesn't seem to be a very high priority for Salina. So we're looking to see what we can do to help educate the community and help them be aware of what and how important it is to my family and how it can benefit the community.
May I have a quick question? I was kind of under the impression we weren't even going to talk about the design of the complex today until the city manager brought it up, but I was also under the impression that the Salina Aquatics Club was willing to consider a pool that would be 50 meters in length and with lanes, but could also be incorporated into the general purpose pool and not be a separate body of water. City manager mentioned separate body of water. Which one are we talking about here? Which one does the Salina Aquatics Club want? Let's say that first.
Debbie Smith would like to talk to.
I'm Debbie Smith. I'm head coach of the Salina Aquatics Club. And we would be happy with either one. The choice that you have, the difference is we compete in pools that are separate, 50-meter pools. We also compete in pools that have the zero depth entry.
On the side.
Yeah, so you would have an option.
Pictures that Steve showed at the meeting that one lady showed and had it for us, it showed both options. Mm-hmm. That 50-meter pool was incorporated in different options.
The one thing, the advantage to having a completely separate pool would be you would be able to have the aquatic center, the aquatic park open at the same time we would be hosting a swim meet. That would be the only difference. We just finished our Division II championships in Derby, mm-hmm, the end of July, and that's what happened. We compete in Hutchinson. Their pool is separate, but there is, I believe, a zero depth in the area. They close the water park and host meet only in the morning. They open up at 1 o'clock in the afternoon because they don't have the adequate restroom facilities to have each one closed off. Does that answer your question?
Not really, but it's making progress. Thank you.
Okay. At this point in time, we just would request that a 50-meter pool that is that we would be able to train and compete in.
Okay. So it could be incorporated in a general purpose play pool.
Yes, it could be.
Okay.
I have a quick question. In all of the correspondence that we have received, which there is a lot of, I realize there is a lot of consensus among the aquatic club, the one question that wasn't answered on any of these, and I keep asking, is in a perfect world, between May and September, when the pool is opened, how many weekends would the 50-meter pool be used for meets? One weekend.
One, possibly two.
In the entire summer. So you want the 50-meter basically to practice, and then we would only have a meet here two times in the entire summer. And is that like a Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or a Saturday only?
It would depend on what type of meet, whether it was a championship level meet. Those traditionally are 3-day. We have the option on how we bid the meet, on what the meet setup is, whether it is a 2-day or a 3-day.
So on the weekends that you're not here, which would roughly be about 10, the 50-meter pool would be open to the public, and how many people would be swimming in that 50-meter pool that would just be doing it for fun?
May I address this, please?
Please.
Okay. One thing that I think that the general public does not really understand is what the size of the body of water that we're talking about is. The current pool that is in that we have is a 50-yard pool. When we are talking a 50-meter pool, we just want a little bit more. Okay? If you go with a 25-meter or a 25-yard pool, it is the size of the YMCA pool or South High. In a town the size of Salina, I don't know how many of you have been to the surrounding water parks, but on a hot day, when you have features there and there's lines, you always have people in the main body of water. Okay? You have families who are, that may be the only time they get to practice with their kids what the kids have been learning in swimming lessons. That may be the only time grandma can come see what the kids have been learning in swimming lessons and be able to float around in the same body of water. There's not, when we practice at South High, or and we have 60 swimmers in the water at one time, it's very crowded. And that's a very organized 60 swimmers in the water.
So I can visualize this, is 50 meters about the length of our pool east to west?
No.
East to west. Is that about 50 meters?
Okay.
If you did it the lengthwise.
Lengthwise.
Not the widthwise.
Right.
The widthwise is what you're saying is 25 yards?
Right. That's correct.
And so if we did it east to west, in my head I'm trying to visualize, that would be about 50 meters. So that's about twice the size.
No.
Maybe another third.
It would be the same.
Same.
75 inches longer.
Okay.
That's it.
75 right, there we go.
Longer.
Okay.
Yes.
Width
that's all.
Doesn't matter necessarily.
Right. It's the swimming length.
Right.
And how many lanes are in a 50-yard meter pool?
It depends. That's where you get into the Olympic pool size or into just a competitive size. We would like 8 lanes.
Which is Olympic?
No. 10 is Olympic.
Okay. These are questions that I am the general public and I don't know.
That's okay.
So
that's
thank
why
you.
We are here. So thanks.
Quick question, Jason. I was initially leaning towards opposition on a 50-meter pool, but in being a little more open to ideas, am interested at least in this. And certainly after watching the American men's 4x100 relay the other night, which was phenomenal. Jason, have in terms of the design as sort of a contingency. Have the designers, they probably haven't thought a whole lot about the 50-meter and some of the preliminary stuff that they've done, or do we know?
I'd like to ask Steve to come up, and while he's coming up, Steve Snyder, our Park and Rec Director, I'll try to fill in some of that. A couple of things. They know enough to guesstimate that the difference, if it is a separate body of water, would probably be between 1.5 and 1.7 million. They know that much. And in the current concept, they're far enough to be looking at the lap area as a separate body of water. The reason for that is while I think you could easily design that within the general area, at depths and so forth, that would certainly work for competitive swimming. Those depths are deep enough that they're typically deeper than what you find in a traditional water park setting. So while there may be people in there using them, using that area, if you're really looking at the volumes of people per square foot, and you were able to just take a camera and, you know, look down, you're going to see a lot less activity in an open area of water than you are where you have the fun splashy climbing things, all the, you know, all the fun stuff that is part of a recreational water park. And so I think from our perspective, whichever you do, whether you go with a 25-yard or a 50-meter, I think Steve will say that he agrees and the consultant agrees that you probably do want to have a separate body of water. That also makes it to where if they want to practice at just about any time, they can do that, and the rest of the pool is, you know, open for the general public for that recreational use as well. Steve?
I would agree with that. Even if it's limited to one or two weekends a year, which we're finding the same thing when we're checking on surveys of how many people at 50 meters, how many meets they're holding. If you're going to do it, it should be, we recommend a separate body just for that scenario of not having to close the aquatic, family aquatic park side of things. As well as practices, I think if you have a combined body of water and you have zero depth and the splashing and you've got the practices going on, I know that they practice various times of the day, early in the morning, late, but I would see sometimes at the same time use of that pool, it would just be a better situation to have a separate body of water for a 50 meter if you're going to go that route.
Steve, just for clarification on a comment the young lady made, as far as the soccer fields, those are open to the public. They're not restricted to the Salina Soccer Club.
That's correct.
Thank you.
We have Parks and Rec leagues. We have a Hispanic league. We have the Salina Soccer Club leagues. We have requests from the school district to use them, so they're open to the general public.
Right. Thank you very much. Any other questions of staff? Further public comments? Jason? Public comments?
I just did wonder real quick. Mike Maddox, 608 McAdams. On it, and I understand the idea of the separate and not, and I know you need to be a steward of the funds, and I'm a taxpayer as well, as I would like to figure out a way to incorporate it within the deal. McPherson is able to do it, and I've been to McPherson several times, and we make the trek down to McPherson to go to the water park down there, and they were able to do it. In the presentation you gave, you said, you know, we can't just take McPherson's pool and put it in Salina because we've got twice the number of people in Salina. We need more space. Well, they were able to do it and incorporate that 50-meter pool into it. The zero depth, it goes the zero depth, and it's not the full wall. Does the zero depths goes into a deeper one? There's like a little separation wall where then it goes into the other area of the pool. In practice times, they practice before I get up. most of the time, even so, they practice early in the morning. In summer, they go from 6 to 9 a.m.
And then if there was a tournament, they would do in the morning to where they would have
right.
to close the pool.
Right, they would have.
But then they're open to the public in the afternoon.
Yes,
which is that's how you're nodding your head.
My name's Harry Kazicki. I'm the president of the Salina Aquatics Club. I live at 1357 Camp Road, Solomon, Kansas. I coach a couple of soccer teams here in Salina, and obviously I'm involved with the swim team. I spend a lot of time and purchase a lot of things here in Salina, so the sales tax affects me quite a bit, and I think that the 50-meter pool is a necessity for this community if you want to have swimmers. We talked about the depth of the pool, and there wouldn't be a lot of people in there. I don't know if you noticed after the races, the swimmers stand up. It doesn't have to be 12 feet deep to be a competitive pool. It can be 4 foot, 5 foot, and the swimmers can swim. There's a depth, there's an entry depth off the blocks that's a required depth for a certain distance, like 15 yards from the end of the pool, but the rest of it doesn't have to be very deep at all. I think that you could, it's pretty easily designed into the body of water that is the main portion. You would lose a couple of hours during the weekend that we would host meets, but for the most part, there wouldn't be time taken from the park, from the use of the park as entertainment for the competitive swimmers. The competitive swimmers practice at different hours. I think some of the concerns may be that you see other smaller leagues in and around this area. My kids also not only swim for the Salina Aquatics Club, but they also swim for the Solomon Hurricanes. That league is based on a 25-yard length. And for people that aren't competitive swimmers, that just as a recreation would like to join a swim team, that's usually what you swim, 25 yards. And I think that is part of the reason that the Parks and Rec Department has leaned towards a 25-yard pool. Well, if you take an 8-lane, 50-meter pool, it's about 22 yards wide using standard width of lanes. So if you would just add 3 yards to that, you could have a 25-yard wide area and have a 25-yard length for swimming 25-yard competitive or recreational leagues. I don't think it has to be a one or the other. I'm, as the Salina Aquatics Club is for that, because we get swimmers that start out as recreational swimmers and find they like it, that it's good exercise and they like it. So that's where we get a lot of our swimmers. So we would like to see that as something to consider in the design.
Any further public comment? Okay, bring it back to the commission for action.
I ask one other question.
Absolutely.
I'm sitting here thinking the shorter this question is, the better, and citizens will appreciate us getting to the point on this ballot question. Is the reference to financing and equipping the new pool necessary? To me, would that not be implied? I'm thinking that instead of saying major equipment, financing, constructing, equipping, supplying, and maintaining a family aquatic park, you could just shorten that and say construction, operation, and maintenance of family aquatic park. Would that still cover everything?
I'm going to look at Jared. I think if the word operation is in there, then that would clearly cover everything. Yeah, I think so. Commissioners, real quick on the property tax stabilization phrase that's in there. The certainly, if that's out, it would not inhibit in any way your ability to fund anything that would look and feel like a capital improvement that would otherwise be funded out of, the, say, the general fund or wouldn't be funded at all. What it would affect, though, is if you chose it, our past practice and the way this was originally set up is that the special sales tax fund would have the ability to transfer cash to the general fund to help offset costs, about $250,000 or so, somewhere in there, and it's a little more this year, to help offset the impact of expenditures in that fund, and that's the way the property tax stabilization has been used. If you're not worried about that, because you have the option of financing equipment and things, then you're fine. If you want to be able to have a direct transfer of a budgeted amount of funds into the general fund, then you'd want to put the property, you'd want to leave the property tax stabilization language in there. So it just depends on how you want to use it. Either way, you can probably accomplish the same goal, I would think.
Well, and when Alan was dissecting this, parks and recreation capital improvement projects wouldn't take care of it?
Well, I was going to delete that line and just put in, used to be the cost of capital improvement projects.
But don't you have to specify the parks and recreation?
No, but we're specifying the aquatic park.
So parks and recreation would fall under the aquatic park?
Falls under general.
Just under general.
Yeah, commissioners, really, the phrase parks and recreation capital improvement projects probably is, it's more specific, it probably is redundant when you look at capital improvement projects, because that's all-encompassing. Again, that was just borrowed from the other language. The idea of isolating the any language that deals with the family aquatic park, the purpose there is really to send a message that says that this tax, you're intending to build a family aquatic park as well as do these other things, whereas before it wasn't in there, so it was optional. The commission could do it. In this case, didn't. It didn't seem that it was something that could be done. But for this, it says we're going to do it. So for those that are watching it just for that, it's a pretty strong commitment. But I think you could go with, I think you'd want to have financing, that's important, but constructing, operating, and maintaining, I think, would satisfy the intent.
One other comment. The date. I guess my thought has been, if this commences on July 1, 2010, it's more appropriately an extension of that quarter cent, which more accurately portrays my mind what we're wanting to do, but kind of curious if anybody else up here had thoughts on that.
Well, I just thought it was interesting that we could do such a thing, because this ordinance question, I think the previous one, this one says it shall terminate 10 years after. I think the previous one said it shall terminate 5 years after.
6 years.
Or 6 years after. So I guess that means that doesn't really matter.
Because we'll have the right to change it as we go along.
If we had the right to go for an even higher sales tax at some point, say 3 or 4 years down the line.
We don't have to wait the 10 years.
We wouldn't have to wait 10 years to initiate, say, another half cent.
Is that correct?
Sales tax.
Well, we'd only have a tenth of a cent left.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Unless the state,
or do I need to check with legal?
Limits, which is another possibility.
Does a commissioner have... Oh, I'm sorry, Jason, go ahead.
I was just checking with our counsel on the question of that date, because when it says as soon as thereafter is permitted by law, my question was, if you had it worded as it is here, does it still allow you to, once we look at all this, look at the financing, cash flows, and so forth, does it allow you to push that off later? Jared indicated probably not. The bond counsel would probably want that date changed if we were going to, the intention was just to wait. The biggest impact of this is again, if you go from a current quarter cent, you're gonna have a little bit of an issue in that transitional period once you get the obligation out, if this is approved and you start moving. And this would be this would help eliminate that difference in the revenue that you're gonna have in over that time. That's really what it's for.
So the proposed ordinance that you have here repeals the other, or does it?
Yeah. That's correct. Yeah.
That is correct.
That doesn't really help much when you say bond council probably.
I can comment to that if you want. I can comment to that, Mayor.
Go ahead.
The language in there, as soon thereafter is permitted by law, that was directly inputted by bond counsel. Her concern, and the concern there is, after the election on November 4th, the sales tax is not levied until some proper paperwork is submitted. If something happens and there's a delay or it gets kicked back and we don't meet the April 1st, 2009 statutory time frame, then it would be the next time period as soon as permitted by law. That was the intent of that language. It was kind of to cover in case something happened at that point. So, I was speculating, but I would guess, and my thought would be that if you intend to have it take over July of 2010, to take over that quarter cent naturally, then that would be the language included in here. I'd verify that with her, but I'm pretty confident that's what she would say as well, is to include that in the ballot.
Commissioners, we think we could, if you wanted to do that, we think we could do that on second reading. So,
does a commissioner have a specific amendment to this charter ordinance that they'd like to submit?
I have a.
Or specific amendments that we could list?
Be specific about the kind of repeating the things that I said my first questions, or
we'll have to have something to vote on.
I wrote up a version of this with the changes, but I have the commencement date July 1st, 2010. Is it the consensus of the group they want to stick with this wording for first reading, or?
Are you submitting that?
Getting the cash flow earlier does have a big advantage on if we jump off the deep end to do this, the sooner you get the cash flow, the better. So
okay,
I'll go ahead and go with the April.
I'll put a proposal down to have something to vote on. And before I do that, I want to make one comment regarding this human services fund. I have always supported monies for Smart Start because we leverage $4 from the state tobacco settlement funds for every dollar that we spend. And my thought is that under my proposed ordinance, the Smart Start people could apply for that through the economic development funds. They're always saying that that's an economic development issue anyway, and so I don't want this to be interpreted as trying to cut them off, because it's not. I support that. Okay, I would move that we have a number on this.
There is. It's ordinance number 0810460.
Yeah, Commissioners, the first ordinance is the charter ordinance.
You want to do it first?
I don't know if it really matters. We felt that the charter ordinance gives you the purchasing ability, or the bond levying ability, and then the next one
okay.
puts
okay.
it out on
there. I would move that we pass first reading charter ordinance 34, allowing the city to issue up to $12.5 million in bonds for the construction of the Family Aquatic Park.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve charter ordinance numbers 34. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Okay.
I would move that we pass ordinance number 08-10460. Submitting the following question to the voters at the November 4th, 2008 general election. Shall the city of Salina, Kansas be authorized to impose a 0.40% citywide retailer's special purpose sales tax to commence on April 1, 2009, or as soon thereafter as permitted by law, and shall terminate 10 years after its commencement, the proceeds of which shall be used to pay for the cost of capital improvement projects, major equipment, construction, operation, and maintenance of the Family Aquatic Park in the Kenwood Park area, debt service on bonds issued for such projects, and the continuation of an economic development fund managed by the city of Salina.
I would second that motion.
Go ahead, Jason.
One thing, Commissioners, we talked about the word financing. We would like the word financing in there, and the main reason is because it will need to be financed, and that will include both principal, which is the direct cost of construction, plus interest. And we feel a little more comfortable having financing in because there's no question that principal plus interest could be covered by this. That's really the main
if
reason.
If you have the phrase debt service on bonds issued for such projects,
yeah.
Would that cover that?
Yeah, yeah, that would get it.
Well, we had that.
Yeah, we had that.
We had that.
Okay.
My question... on your motion, you're eliminating property tax stabilization. And if I understood our city manager correctly, unless that's specifically mentioned in there, future city commissions would lose the ability to transfer sales tax funds to the general fund. Is that correct?
Yeah, we believe so, because I don't believe that direct transfer would relate into the intended uses here. But the other way you could offset that is if you believe that by using that special sales tax to fund capital items that you would otherwise have expected to fund from the general fund, then you can't offset the general fund in that way. So again, it really just depends on how you would like to emphasize property tax stabilization, a direct cash infusion, or just simply funding capital items that you would otherwise fund out of the general fund, which you could do that.
So we want to keep that in there.
My thought had been that wasn't, I understand what you're saying. To me, this whole issue implies that, and it's not necessary to, just a way of trying to shorten the.
I think if it implies it, we're better off explicitly stating it.
Indeed.
So are you amending that, or are you changing that?
I would ask for that.
Okay, I'll add that in to the motion. And after the phrase debt service on bonds issued for such projects, property tax stabilization, and the continuation of the economic development fund managed by the City of Salina.
So we haven't done a whole lot other than take out human service grants and took out some of the verbiage along with capital improvement, parks and rec capital improvement projects, right?
Right. Minimize the redundancy.
Okay. Yeah.
And I would ask the clerk to please read that back so everyone is very clear on what we're voting on.
And
here she came.
The second consents.
You made a amendment.
Okay.
Gotcha.
Okay.
I have most of it, not all of it.
Okay.
Please.
Can I read it back?
Yes.
Okay. Shall the City of Salina, Kansas be authorized to impose a 0.40% citywide retailer's special purpose tax?
Sales tax.
To commence on April 1, 2009, or as soon thereafter as permitted by law, and shall terminate 10 years after its commencement. Proceeds of which shall be used to pay the cost of capital improvement projects, major equipment, construction, operation, and maintenance of a family aquatic park in the Kenwood Park area, debt service on bonds issued for such projects, property tax stabilization, and the continuation of an economic development fund managed by the City of Salina.
Was there a second to that?
Yes,
I seconded the original and agree to the amendment.
Okay, it was moved and seconded to adopt on first reading ordinance 0810460 as amended. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Passes 5-0. Do we have any other business? We will stand adjourned then. Thank you.
Second.
Sorry.